to all rise, I'll have the invocation and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for the many blessings we have received in our city. As we move forward on various issues this evening, guide us. As we serve the community in the coming days, strengthen us to do what is right. And Lord, we especially ask that we stay mindful of those in need. We ask for your help to understand each individual we represent and to make the best decisions for our community. Tonight again, we ask for your blessing and presence be felt by those who serve our country, as well as our public safety employees who serve our nation, state, and city. Guide and protect them and bring comfort to their families as they protect all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Tonight we don't have any special presentations to give, so we'll move straight to our audience for visitors. If there's anybody that would like to address council on any subject, and noting that we have three public hearings this evening, if you're here to discuss one of the issues that are, or was it five? I'm sorry, five public hearings this evening. If you're here to address one of those, please reserve your comment until those public hearings are held. But if you would like to address City Council on anything that is not on the agenda, or now is the time to do that. That is the pre-budget public hearing. So yes, if you'll wait just 1 second, that's very next. Okay. Seeing no speakers, close the audience for visitors and ask for approval of the minutes.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve the minutes of the regular meeting of January 14th, 2013.
Second.
A motion made and seconded that we approve the minutes of the regular session of January 14th. Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Vernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
And the work session?
Mr. Mayor, I move approval of the work session, minutes of the work session of January 14th, 2013.
Second.
A motion made and seconded that we approve those also. Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Councilman Vernal.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. And now we enter the first of the public hearings. And the first public hearing is a pre-budget public hearing. And Randy, I'm assuming staff has a presentation that you'd like to give so that the community understands, and then we'll take any comment on that.
All right, thank you, Mr. Mayor. As council members are aware, but not all members of the public, maybe, each year before we begin the deliberative process on the budget, both the preparation city manager's budget and as a precursor to your budget, deliberations, which have in themselves a later public hearing, we ask the public for their feedback. What should we be thinking about in their mind before we even start in earnest? What we've got is a short presentation. Council members are generally aware with the things we're going to go over, but Teresa, we're working, we're technology challenged today, so we're working from the booth rather than the dais because our one computer that worked died earlier today. So bear with us just a little bit. Teresa?
Is that computer in the budget for the next year?
No, sir.
I just checked.
Okay. For the public and as a reminder to council members, you will recall that this year that we're going into is really the sixth year of the recession. Now, we've come out of it largely and that it's not pulling us backwards, but we're not surging forward to the extent that we wish we would. Certainly a post-recessionary emergence. We're not there yet. Last year, you'll recall that at this time last year, we spoke with you and every single one of our major governmental funds was in structural deficit, which meant that our operating expenses exceeded our operating revenue in each fund. That came as we tightened our belt, used our savings and other choices through the course of the recession. We'd gotten to the point where that was unsustainable. Last year, working with the City Council, we prepared a plan to address two-thirds of that issue, and we were successful in passing that plan. That plan was the basis of not only getting us through last year's budget, but also a significant bond credit upgrade, which had the effect of saving the citizens' money over time and the money that we've borrowed. This coming year, and perhaps the few after that, is when we really have the most difficult of the issues to address, even though it's not as large as some of those others that you've addressed so far. That's the general fund imbalance. As I said, we're going into the sixth recessionary influence budget. As you know, we have no locally funded capital projects of any significance. We have done reductions in force at both the city at a level exceeding 10% of our workforce. Schools have also made significant reductions. We have refinanced and restructured our debt last year, the year we're in now, really. The council approved increases to our meals tax and cigarette tax. We have really struggled to maintain maintenance. You'd asked jokingly whether the computer was in the budget. There is no money for that sort of thing and hasn't been for years. We have to make a choice based on hopeful temporary good fortune, like a vacancy or something. We do what we can, but there is no maintenance budget, there is no capital equipment budget, there is no locally funded capital budget. And these are the kinds of steps that we and lots of others have taken to get through the recession. Next, Teresa, thank you. Said that we're emerging, but haven't emerged yet from the recession. We continue to return money to the general fund balance at the end of each year. You can see here that our unassigned general fund balance at the end of last year, that's the June 30th, 2012, just a shade under $5 million. That includes the 15% reserves that are required by your own policy and also cash flow, and some additional money beyond that. And we have been using that excess fund balance for the last few years to maintain governmental services without a tax increase. That second line you see is that in the budget we just finished, we thought we would have to go to our savings account for $285,000 to balance the budget. In the end, we only used 50. That meant there was $235,000 worth of good news financially in that budget. We are careful with vacancies, and we save it rather than spend it. We also are seeing increases in our local tax collections, sales tax, meals tax, independent of the rate adjustments. In most cases, we're seeing small but improvements. They're moving in the right direction. They're not together moving enough to take us out of this recession in the short run, but at least they're moving in the right direction. Next, please. This year, also, to let you know where we are, we've had a solid year. It means our revenue collections are holding. That's the first thing you want. You hope for maybe a slight increase, but you first want them to hold. Meals taxes continue to increase. We have lots of things to be thankful for there, not the least of which is several new restaurants, including Surf's Up and Wendy's, and also the redesigned and reopened Top of the Smoothies. And
Thank you.
I don't know why I was missing that one. That's a big one. So in the areas that really reflect the local government or the local economy, exclusive of housing, we seem to be doing fairly well. We've also had some additional expenditures. Hurricane Sandy, obviously, that's another reason why we have a fund balance. because sometimes we will have something like this roll through and it will not result in a federal disaster declaration for us and not result in the federal government paying a significant portion of our expenses. But we still need to do what we need to do to keep our people and our city safe. I'm glad to tell you that our sewer revenues are meeting projection and solid waste is meeting projection. So the things that you solved through the tough decisions you had to make this time last year or 10 months ago, I'm happy to say that they're holding and they're doing the job that you approved them to do. As we go into the next fiscal year, the one that starts in July, we have challenges in front of us. These are not unlike things you've seen in the past. I'll go quickly through three slides because I think that it's important to look at our budget not as a series of one-year events, but as a fiscal story, a book of many chapters. The next chapter is 2014. We know that we're going to have additional requirements from the Virginia Retirement System. That's a state requirement that we can do nothing about except to pay it. We know, or we expect, increased health insurance. And if you read the Daily Press today, front page above the fold, they were talking about the impacts of the new health care laws on local governments. We'll see those too, in addition to regular rate increases. We have coming at us, but not yet quantified, significant TMDL requirements from the EPA. Those are not requirements that we have or you have brought on yourself, but are rather being imposed on us by a combination of federal government and state government. We will also see significant new requirements, and they may actually hit us sooner than the TMDL requirements relating to state stormwater, and we're actually going to talk a little bit about that later in the agenda. But essentially, the state is shifting their stormwater program to local governments in the form of an unfunded mandate. As we've seen in the past several years, our natural revenue growth is less than our natural growth in costs. And these are just the kind of costs. We're not talking about adding employees. We're not talking about adding new programs or salary increases or anything like that. Another significant issue for next year, which is yet to be fully fleshed out, is it's a real property reassessment year. That will affect your budget deliberations as it does every other year. And lastly, we expect continued reductions in state funding for schools. The superintendent recently did a briefing for the school board, and through a combination of reductions in state revenue and increases in costs beyond their control, like VRS, their gap is somewhere in the neighborhood of $500,000. In addition, the governor's proposal for a 2% raise, which the state would pay some portion of, but not all, might increase that gap if that raise was to be awarded to all employees to an amount cumulatively would be approaching $800,000. So I say that to say that our school system has got yet another challenge of declining revenue. School system, despite your efforts in increasing local support, has been reduced each year since I've been here. That's what 14 looks like, and that's the year that you will be getting a budget from me in about 2 months to address. I'll go quicker here. Many of these are the same, so I won't go over them, except on this one, we're going to be closer to the TMDL requirement. It was to get 60% of it done in 7 years, and we're 2 years plus in. And we still don't know what we're supposed to do. But that's not because we're not trying. The increase for the debt service, you recall, we lowered the rate through the refinancing, took advantage of a good rate, and restructured. Well, that debt service, which is coming primarily as a result of the elementary school that was built several years ago, new fire station, the fields, all of that, we have been restructuring our debt and refinancing our debt since before the recession hit us in an effort to buy time in having to deal with those requirements. Will the first significant portion, slightly less than $600,000 of that annual debt service for 20 years is coming due, not 18 years, something like that, coming due in 15. That's in addition to everything else. And we don't know what the second year will bring for school funding. If recent history is a guide, the answer is not good news. But having said that, I believe 15 is a year where the what is the school funding formula called?
Local composite index.
Thank you, sir. The composite index is being updated, and it's possible that we might see a positive shift. If so, it would be the first one in recent memory, but it is possible. We won't know that until this time next year or thereabouts. 16 is the third year of the three we're looking at, and you'll see, again, the same sorts of things. You see the things that confront us every year. Health insurance costs, TMDL requirements, which are state and federal, so is the stormwater, debt service, the last second of two pieces for the elementary school, the fire station. That comes in, it gets to about $900,000 more than we have now going to debt. And then it'll stay that way for almost two decades. But that's money that we do not have in our revenue stream right now to pay for it. Again, 16 will be a reassessment year. And again, school funding is unknown. So these are the kinds of things that we worry about as we're trying to do multi-year planning. We're going to show you in a second a chart or two. But from a planning perspective, and the things that we're talking about so far, as I said before, you've not seen any new programs of any kind. No cost of living adjustments, no local capital funding of any kind, no additional local funding for schools. That does not mean that's a recommendation. That simply means when we model how bad our base situation is, we keep local funding for schools the same for the purpose of comparison. We use our fund balance, our general fund balance, in excess of our guidelines, to the extent that there is money available, to forestall future tax increases or governmental restructuring in 15 and 16. By 16, that money is no longer available. And the last assumption is that we maintain our fund balance in accordance with our financial policies. That's important. That's what backs our debt rating. But more importantly for us, because of our size, that's how we keep from bouncing checks, because our revenue source is not 1/12 a month for 12 months, but essentially comes in two large collections around real estate. And we have a cash flow issue between, and it is that 15% general fund balance that your policy is tied to that really allows us to go through the intervening months. Next, please. As we go forward, we have many issues to think about that we have to think about as staff and you have to think about. If we live with our most conservative assumptions, reassessment notwithstanding, we can delay some of the hard decisions. In doing so, they get harder. We can seek revenue options to increase our revenue. We can seek reductions in expenditures. The types of reductions that we would need would be significant. So what we would be talking about is things that we're just not going to do anymore. That would be the nature of that conversation, or a combination of the two. That's something that I'll need to deal with as I go forward in the budget, and certainly something that you will need to deal with, as well as the school board is dealing with it with the superintendent now. Teresa, this is the last slide. What we wanted to show you, and council members, you've seen this, and this is the numerical representation of what we've talked about up till now. Assuming that there is no increase in tax rates or taxes, again, reassessment notwithstanding, that's a separate issue which we'll have to deal with if we have to deal with it. But this is presented with a zero net reassessment. With those assumptions of no new programs, pay raises, or anything like that, you can see the reflection, I'll just use the first column, for example, First number is our budget for FY13. Going forward, well, we don't have any debt service increase because of the issues that, the way that you dealt with it last year. We're looking at VRS increases from the state, which are beyond our control. There is a small amount of money, which is literally a drop in a much larger bucket on TMDL. A working estimate on health insurance, which may be up or down, don't know. And the issue of the need to capitalize the EDA's line of credit. Those are issues that are driving us on the expenditure side, and the only ones for the purposes of the model. You see, then the revenue that we had to apply to the budget, the amount of fund balance use that was adopted as part of the current budget, additional revenue, remember we said that we'd had a solid year so far, we'd actually seen an increase in revenue over projection by about $106,000, so you see that reflected here, and an additional growth estimate based on our base that already does include, or in addition to the 106. So you can see what the revenues to expenses look like there. Well, the 695 actually, I didn't state that very well before. That's the amount of fund balance that would be required to make that particular budget balance. You can see then that our fund balance to a percentage, as a percentage, remember your guideline is 12 to 15. Below 15 is really where you begin to have significant issues, stands at 15.77%. Based on that very conservative set of assumptions, we can choose to delay solving the more dramatic structural problems until the following year. That is one choice. And in the following years, I won't go down each column, you'll see the amount of fund balance that we have to allocate. You'll see that at some point, not only do we not have excess fund balance, but we actually need to contribute it back to maintain our fund balance. You'll see the emergence in the middle column, about in the middle, of a $278,000 debt service fund reserve. That's money that you set aside when we saved the money this past year. Rather than repurpose the savings, you chose, at our recommendations, to specifically hold on to it for the reason that you were going to need it, which is debt. And what you see is that beginning in 15 and 16, it begins to have significant impacts on us. So through this budget process, we'll need to decide, and ultimately you'll need to decide, whether or not we need to begin to attack this now, whether we need to attack this on the revenue side, whether or not we really need to look at our government and decide what things we've traditionally done that we no longer want to do, or a combination. And is there one more slide?
That's it.
That's it.
Okay. And you don't have to make that decision tonight, because this is really for public input. But I would just say that I draw your attention to the negative bracketed numbers in the second and third column, the lower of the two, 973,000 and 2.46 million. That's the magnitude of the types of decisions that will need to be made, and they're additive, over the three-year period. Whether it's governmental restructuring or some sort of revenue option or combination, that's the size of the nut to crack based on those assumptions, which are very conservative in themselves. So we are fortunate that we've got a year in front of us that we can plan and we can begin to make decisions. And over the next few months, we will work with you on what those decision parameters will be. But tonight's purpose is to hear from the public on comments and suggestions that they may have for inclusion in the budget, for changes to the budget, for really anything pertaining to the budget, to include the capital budget, to include the local contribution for schools, and any tax rate, fee, or governmental service we provide.
Yeah, thank you, Randy. Thank you, Teresa, for putting the presentation together. Are there any questions of council before I move on to the public hearing? Okay, so this is Randy's laid out basically what we have discussed in an offsite meeting and what council is very interested in is any comments this evening from the public that on how they would like to see us approach the upcoming budget, and specifically anything, like I said, we've tried to give you a snapshot of not just next year, which is what we sort of used to do, but the future, the next three years of the city as we see it. So without any further comment from us, I'd like to open that public hearing. And if there's anybody that would like to address council on this pre-budget public hearing, now is the time to do that. Yes, sir. And sir, I appreciate it if you would just let us know your name and your address. Thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Alton Williams. I live at 46 Bellmore Drive in Bocosin. Been here, I'm not a native of Bocosin, but I've been here for over 20 years. And the reason I moved here, and my wife and I, was she had two sisters and brother-in-laws here. We had a daughter and son-in-law here, and we liked Bocosin. We lived in Grafton, so we moved over here in 1990. If you recall, back in 1990, there was also a sort of a dead spell on real estate. We bought a home. We bought this home in Bellmore at a very reasonable price. I went through my taxes and stuff today. Oh, excuse me. We bought the home in 1990 at $173,900. The taxes then was $1,400 a year. The next year they went up to $1,594. And then we had an assessment. In 92, the total price of our home was worth $173,400. But the taxes went up to $1,815. Then I missed a few years in my keeping my records. But in 1996, the assessor said our home was worth $191,000, and the taxes was $2,140. In 1998, I had another assessment. It said it was worth $200,800. Taxes went to $2,249. And then it was reassessed every 2 years, as I guess the normal assessment goes. It went on up 221, 245, 294 in 2004. And then in 2006, the assessor come around and said, our home was worth $448,600. But that didn't make me any richer. It just meant my home was a lot more pricier if I wanted to sell it, but I didn't want to sell it. And the taxes that year went to $3,633. But the city dropped the rate per hundred that year. It went from $1.06 per hundred down to 81 cents a hundred. So that gave us a break. But that was $133,700 our property increase by the assessor's calculations. In 2008, the assessor come around and said, well, your home is not worth $324,000. It's only worth $306,000. But your property, your land value went from $124,000 to $177,000. $53,000, my one little lot on Velmore Drive went up $53,000 in 2 years. And I called him and asked him why, and he said, well, people were complaining that their property value wasn't high enough. Well, I think that's only a few people that was complaining, people that wanted to sell land. $53,000 my property went up in 2 years. And it goes on and on. Now, the last year, our property up there is went down to $396,400. But my taxes now are $3,646. And somebody decided that 81 cents to the 100 wasn't good enough. We'll make it 92 cents per 100. And if I recall what I've read now, we want to add 6 cents to the 6 cents per.
Sir, we don't
per 100.
Just so you know, what we have discussed tonight is pre-budget. We do not have a specific discussion out there tonight.
Okay.
So what you have are what we are studying as options. So you're welcome to basically make a comment on one of those options if you would like.
Okay.
We do not have a budget. In fact, the budget won't be approved until April to May.
May.
And we won't even see a budget until March. This is pre-budget.
Okay. Well, let me ask the council members, are you going to approve a increase in taxes? Nobody knows yet.
That's correct.
Okay. But I bet you that on the campaign brochures that you just handed out this last year, every one of them said, no new taxes. Vote for me, no new taxes. So you might consider that.
Okay. Thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to make a comment? Okay, with that, we will close the public hearing. And as we discussed, the City Council does not have a budget before it right now. And Randy will be proposing that. You want to basically go through the budget timeline, and it doesn't have to be to the day, but about what people can expect and when they should be looking for things?
Sure. The City Manager's recommended budget will be presented to City Council on April the 8th, and following that, we will have a public hearing on that budget. I anticipate we will also have a joint session with school board. We'll have, by the time that we get to April 8th, we'll also have the benefit of the school board's recommended budget. And then you have, as council, 45 days, I think it is, to either approve the budget I present or amend it in any way you think is appropriate. Absent that, at the end of the 45th day, the recommended budget becomes the budget. That's never happened in the city, but that's the time period. From the 8th of April, you have 45 days from that point to deliberate, and that's when your public hearing will be.
Okay, so the public hearing on the 8th?
It'll be presented on the 8th.
Presented on the 8th.
Do we have a hearing date yet?
Second meeting in April will be the public hearing on the actual budget.
22nd of April.
Okay. Thank you. And I appreciate the presentation and the information to the public. All right. Next on our public hearings, we have an ordinance amending Article 8, Section 8, Tac 3 of the subdivision ordinance to require the depiction of RPA or resource protection areas on approved subdivision plats. And Randy, if you would like
to. Might I suggest, since these next three come to us as a requirement of state code, that we ask Kevin or Karen to summarize all three at one time so the public can understand the entirety of what we're talking about. And then you can either then proceed public hearing one, two, and three, or having spoken with Wayne, as long as we properly open it, you could actually run them all together.
Okay.
Since we don't have a timeline limit for speakers, that's not problematic.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Okay. Good evening. To give you a little history on this, beginning in the fall of 2011 through winter of 2012, the city underwent an audit of their Chesapeake Bay Act program. This was done by Chesapeake Bay Local Assistance Department, who we refer to as CBLAD. The audit included reviewing files for waivers and exceptions that were granted over the previous 2 years, reviewing our BMP database, policies and procedures, the city ordinance, and even included site visits to various active construction sites. Once the audit was completed, the information was gathered and presented to the Chesapeake Bay Local Assistance Board in a public hearing, March 2012, in which they found our program to be in conditional compliance. The condition was the subdivision zoning and site plan ordinance amendments that are going to be presented to you tonight. It's basically language that we have consistently required on all of our development plans and plats, and it has even been written on our checklists, but it's never been in the ordinance. And so this is basically a housekeeping item. And if you'll bear with me, I'll just go through each one individually. It's pretty redundant, but we'll start with the subdivision ordinance, Article 8, Section 8-3, accurate layout. This is a paragraph that will be expanded to say that all final plats shall include a depiction of the limits of resource protection area and a notation that an undisturbed and vegetated 100-foot buffer shall be maintained. All final plats shall include a notation that development within the 100-foot RPA buffer is limited to redevelopment or water-dependent facilities as determined by the zoning administrator unless otherwise approved by the Board of Zoning Appeals or the Environmental Development Plan Review Committee. That's the subdivision ordinance. And to go on to the zoning ordinance, Article 11.4, Section 11.4-5, special inventory and analysis requirements will be amended by adding subsections 5 and 6. Subsection 5 will read, the depiction of limits of the resource protection area and a notation that an undisturbed and vegetated 100-foot buffer shall be maintained, shall be required on all final plats. And subsection 6 will read, a notation shall be required on all final plats that permitted uses within the 100-foot RPA buffer are limited to redevelopment or water-dependent facilities as determined by the zoning administrator unless otherwise approved by the Board of Zoning Appeals or Environmental Development Plan Review Committee. And then the final one is the site plan ordinance change. That's Article 2, Section 2-2D. Preliminary site plans will be amended by adding subsections 9 and 10. And this is basically a subsection that regards site plan requirements. Subsection 9 will read, the depiction of limits of the resource protection area and a notation that an undisturbed and vegetated 100-foot RPA buffer shall be maintained. And then it'll go on to subsection 10, which will read, a notation that development is limited to redevelopment or water-dependent facilities as determined by the zoning administrator, unless otherwise approved by the Board of Zoning Appeals or Environmental Development Plan Review Committee. Because we're putting this kind of in the middle of those plat requirements, we will be renumbering subsections that are currently numbered 9 through 14 as 11 through 16. If we get these, we've been given a deadline of March 31st, 2013 to get these in our ordinance, and we will be considered fully in compliance once we've done that.
Okay, any questions of council?
One, would you define exactly what we're talking about on redevelopment?
Mm-hmm. Define redevelopment?
Please.
It's a site that's been previously developed that would basically be redeveloped in the same footprint or with the same basic layout.
Okay. I guess this is just one, and it's just dawned on me as you've gone through here. The one thing that we're good about is laying out what we're looking at here on the ordinances. Do we have a citywide map that says where these zones would take place at so we could get
positive, you know, so we can make sure that the people that are affected by this wouldn't just think that this is a, basically a benign thing, because this does affect a lot of people's properties.
The issue, if I understand, Mr. Mayor, is we're simply formalizing what's been our practice already for years and years.
Yes.
So I don't think that we're seeing this as a change practice. So what are you seeing that we missed?
I'm just saying there are places, percussion is unlike a lot of folks. You know, we have, you know, for a city that's only 6 miles wide, I mean, you've heard me say this, we have 84 miles of shoreline. A lot of the shoreline is interior to the city. That's not what a lot of people think, that the RPA is on the boundaries of the outside of the city and reaches in. But we tend to do things that on inlets and drainage ditches and all of those things that are, quote, then deemed tidal, this change would impact them. And what I'm simply asking is, when we did this public hearing, or when we opened this, were we out front and say, hey, here's all the areas that are affected? And I would think that the answer is probably no, because we thought it was more of a housekeeping thing.
We do have kind of a vague, it's hard to pinpoint it exactly because the shoreline is constantly changing, but we do have I believe it's an overlay now on the GIS. Okay. That gives you kind of a suggestion about where the RPAs are. Most people that live on the water seem to know that there's something to be protected there now, because this has been a consistent practice for such a long time.
Okay, now it used to be that the policy or the thing was, there was two designations of RPA. There was what you could do within the first 50 feet. Uh-huh. And the second 50 feet.
And that still stands. We still have to show that, but depending on when your lot was platted, if it's grandfathered, you have a certain amount of
That's
more flexibility.
That's the part that I wanted to make sure that it wasn't a change, because it says an undisturbed 100-foot RPA buffer.
Yes. Yeah.
So it is.
And that's where
same.
We added the unless otherwise approved. There are administrative ways to go about getting exceptions or waivers, but so we didn't want to just say absolutely no RPA disturbance.
Okay.
Is there a definition of where you measure from to get that 100 feet back?
Typically right about the 3-foot contour is where our mean low water line.
So it's from the mean low water line, basically? Mm-hmm. We got that defined someplace?
Or mean high water, I'm sorry.
Mean high water.
Yes,
okay.
3-foot elevation.
Okay. Any other questions?
So this is just cleaning up the language that's already on the books, basically?
Yes. It's just basically putting it in the code, what we've been doing for years.
And do I understand it correctly that these are changes required by the state for us to be in compliance?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. All right, without objection of council, I'm going to open the public hearing, and I'm going to open the public hearing for all three of these ordinances. This would be the ordinance amending Article 8, Section 8, Tag 3, the ordinance amending Article 2, Section 2, Tag 02, and Article 11, Tag 4, Section 11, Tag 4, Tag 5 of the zoning ordinances, all dealing with the depiction of resource protection areas and notations referencing the maintenance of an undisturbed 100-foot RPA buffer, an acknowledgement that permitted uses within the 100-foot RPA buffer must be limited to redevelopment and water-dependent activities. I think that captures everything that I needed to. Any objections to that from council? Okay. If not, then I'll open that public hearing, and if anybody would like to make comment on this, now is that time. Yes, sir. And again, if you could, just let us know your name and your address.
My name's Steve Perman. I live at 38 Forest Road, and I actually didn't come here for this public, other than the pre-budget. But I'm a little concerned when you're saying that this is for title. We built a new house a couple years ago, and the ditch that ran through us that drains the property used to be just for fresh water. It just drained the property. But lately, we've noticed now it's become a title issue where up Forest Road, it backs up through the canal. If you look at the picture, the satellite picture of it, you can see as it meanders. I don't know if it's silted in and this is backing water up, but I'm concerned for the future that now all of a sudden this ditch is becoming a tidal area, and I'm not sure I understand this other than now I can't do anything with the property 100 feet on either side of this ditch. Is that a true statement, or am I off base?
I'll let staff answer that. Sure. It's all dependent on a lot of the things that you say, but would you like to address this question?
Ditches typically, if they're, especially if they are roadside ditches or they drain a public street, are considered utilities and they are exempt from that. We've got them all through
okay,
the city.
But what
we
happens
don't require.
If this is, I guess, a privately owned ditch that, from when I built the house and I talked to the zoning people, you cannot mess with ditches that are set there to help drain property.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when my father bought the place years ago, it was just to drain fresh water. Now it's become an issue because the culvert on going across Forest Road backs up. Mm-hmm. So now it's become a tidal ditch. Every time we have a high tide, it comes in, then it drains back out. When we have events like Sandy and others, it really backs up.
Mm-hmm.
Fresh water, it still drains it, but we still have an issue with the tile. So I'm just trying to understand, even though this has been in place from what I understand, what's going to happen with now with this, according to you all, there's a tile, it becomes a tile issue.
It sounds like from what you're describing, that would be considered a utility.
Still a
utility. If it's draining public streets, it's coming through a culvert.
Okay.
Something like that. If you dug a ditch in your backyard to drain something unrelated, that could possibly be a tidal feature.
But it is a public hearing. And what I would say to you is please make contact, and y'all can talk right after this so that you she can look at your specific situation.
Okay.
And give you some guidance on
that. I just want to make sure that whatever you
We can't give you a yes or no answer.
Sure, I understand. Right, I'm just drawing concern that all of a sudden now there's, on either side of this ditch, I own both sides of it, that's 200 feet that I cannot do something later with.
And it's a good question, and we encourage you to get together
and
get the right answer.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
so
before you leave, your address is what?
38 Forest Road.
Okay, I think it's right near the bend of the road in Forest Road.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That ditch normally used to drain fresh water, okay? And I think it's now doing that. I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but there was a dam at the end of that ditch that washed away in a hurricane, okay? And that's when it became tidal, because that dam washed away, and then the tide was able to wash around a gate valve that was supposed to stop the tide from coming in that ditch. It's my understanding that that has now been repaired. Matter of fact, I know it has. I went down and looked at it. And so it should not be tide flowing into that ditch now. But if there is a high tide, the gate valve closes and it keeps the storm water from draining out freely until the tide goes down. So I don't know if that's considered tidal now or not.
Okay. I understand, sir, because I was here at when I guess you approved to help fund that dam. But I'll keep an eye on it.
And that's a good... That's the best advice we can give you right here tonight.
All right, sir. Appreciate it. And I'll talk to you later. Thank you.
I would think the key is it sounds like that's a flood. During
flood.
Tide,
I agree.
You've got tide in it, which means it would not mean high tide would not. That's still out somewhere. That wouldn't affect the mean high tide. In other words, that water would have to come in there every day.
Oh, it comes in every day. Because I watch it.
It does.
I can watch the flow based on the time coming up through the culvert and across. So that's why.
There are title issues almost everywhere, and yours is no exception. Please do speak with Karen. I would say this, what we're being asked to present or to approve by the state, one, it does reflect what we've been doing for years, but if we don't do it and we're found out of compliance, then they will take over our program and implement it anyway. It's your only discretion here, really, is whether or not we continue to administer our Chesapeake Bay program or whether the state administers it for us. I know that doesn't feel very good because it doesn't feel very good.
That's right. But if we're going to have the public hearing, I just want to make sure that people understand if their property is impacted. And that's the reason for my questions.
Understood.
Okay. All right. Any other comments? Other than that, I agree with Randy. It just doesn't feel very good. All right. So I'll close the public hearing and ask for consideration by council.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt an ordinance amending the subdivision ordinance by revising Article 8, Section 8-3 pertaining to final plat requirements.
Second.
Do you mind if, can we do all three of these as one motion?
Again, okay. And also an ordinance amending the site plan ordinance by revising Article 2, Section 2-02 pertaining to preliminary site plan requirements. And
zoning.
Ordering Article 14, Section 11.4-5 of the zoning ordinance to require the depiction of resource protection areas, notations referencing the maintenance of an undisturbed 100-foot RPA buffer, and acknowledgement that permitted uses within the 100-foot RPA buffer must be limited to redevelopment and water-dependent facilities on all final plats.
Yeah. And was that Section 11?
Not Section 14. 11.
Got it. 11,
I'm
sorry, 11.4. Yeah. Okay.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Concerns or comments by council? Okay. Seeing none, Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman St. Hall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. Next item for consideration of the public hearing is an ordinance amending the zoning ordinance by revising Article 1, Section 1, Tac 3, and Article 5, Section 5, Tac 2, to include a definition for sheds located on a vacant lot and to allow sheds located on a vacant lot as a permitted use in all single-family residential districts.
Kevin will present for staff. And one question we did get, which was a good question, which is why couldn't this just fit into accessory dwellings? And the short answer is an accessory dwelling is an accessory to a principal dwelling. And as you recall, the reason we got into this was to consider allowing sheds when no principal dwelling exists. And rather than try to rework the definition of accessory building, we chose to go with shed because it's a definable size. It's specifically designed not to be garage size, and to help us to avoid some future issues with the further development of the property. So that's the reason we chose to go with a separate classification rather than amending the accessory building classification.
Okay. Yep.
All right. Mayor, honorable members of council, as you recall, at your October 22nd meeting, you were basically presented this language in a shell. Hasn't really changed since then. It's twofold. First, we are creating a new definition. As Randy mentioned, it's calling it a shed on a vacant lot. The word shed implies a smaller structure, and basically we're allowing people to place this on a vacant lot to store various garden tools. We really don't care what they put in there. However, this is what we envision it being used for. Sheds, by their very nature, are smaller and have a minimal impact on adjacent properties. We will define a shed on a vacant lot as a structure not to exceed 250 square feet in area located on a lot absent of a principal structure and used for the primary purpose of storing miscellaneous household items, garden tools, and equipment. These structures shall meet the front yard setback established for their zoning district, as well as all height and setback requirements established for accessory structures. No more than one structure shall be permitted per vacant lot. These structures are permitted to be served by electrical utilities, however, shall not be serviced by water or sewer utilities. That last portion there was a topic of discussion at the Planning Commission meeting. We're basically allowing garden sheds, and Planning Commission made a very good point. If we're allowing garden sheds, why at least not on the exterior are we not permitting water and sewer utilities? Water, obviously, to water the lawns or flowers, any gardens on the property. So that language can be amended tonight. It was a suggestion by the Planning Commission that you just look at it prior to the adoption of this ordinance. The second portion of this will amend Article 5, Section 5-2, which regulates all permitted uses within the single-family residential districts within the city, being the RS, R1, and R2 districts, not to include the multifamily residential district, R3. We would introduce this as a permitted use by right, and it would allow these structures to be placed on any vacant lot within these single-family residential districts. And before I conclude, I want to address one item. The size allowance that we've established, this 250 square feet, was selected carefully. First of all, we don't want people to put garages on their property. Those could turn into principal uses and certainly have much more impact on adjacent properties than a garden shed would. The typical size for a single car garage is 12 by 22, or 264 square feet. So by limiting it at 250 square feet, we're not getting into garage territory, if you will, and will certainly pose a much less impactful presence in a neighborhood than a garage would. With that being said, I can answer any questions you may have.
One question, Kevin. Is there allowance for this definition of shed to be on a lot where there is an existing dwelling?
Lots where there are existing dwellings, those would still be considered accessory structures, and they would be confined to those requirements.
That's not good. Would the accessory structures be limited to the same square foot area as the sheds?
Accessory structure size is determined by the size of the principal structure on the property. An accessory structure is not allowed to exceed 50% of the square footage of the principal structure. So that's where those size limits
okay,
are.
Okay, so if you had a 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 square foot house, a 250 foot shed size structure would be allowed?
It would certainly be allowed.
Okay.
Certainly. Yeah.
That would include a freestanding garage, obviously.
Obviously, yes.
I think the distinction, correct me, Kevin, if I'm wrong, is if you have a principal dwelling, then the size of your shed-like building could be larger under the definition of accessory. We're trying to get at what you can build on a vacant lot right, without overwhelming the neighborhood, but to allow you to better caretake your property.
Okay.
And I do think having water, at least on the exterior, is an advantage. I mean, to put, you could have lawn water and stuff all over the place, buried in the ground, and we put a building there and said, but you can't have water in it. That doesn't make a lot of sense.
You clean your equipment, everything else.
Yeah, you can wash off your lawnmower, whatever you need to.
So, how did Planning Commission pass this? With the language here? They passed it, shall not be serviced by water and sewer utilities, but they're asking us to take another look at that?
Yes, that's what they've asked.
Okay. Any other questions? Not? Then we'll open the public hearing and receive any comments on this particular ordinance. Okay, seeing no one, I will close the public hearing and ask for consideration by council.
Hey, I'd like to move that we adopt an ordinance amending the zoning ordinance by revising Article 1, General Provisions, Section 1 through 3, with the addition of, in the second part of the definition, these structures are permitted to be served by electrical utilities, however, shall not be serviced by water except on the exterior of the shed and no sewer.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Yeah.
Okay. Motion made and seconded that we proceed with this ordinance, giving the allowance for water in addition to electric power, but no sewer. Any further questions or comments? Judy, please.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, under new business, we have a resolution authorizing the execution of a multi-jurisdictional law enforcement mutual aid agreement.
Mr. Mayor, this is an amendment to an existing agreement to which we are a party, which includes at present Chesapeake, Franklin, Hampton, Newport News, Norfolk, ourselves, Portsmouth, Suffolk, Virginia Beach, Williamsburg, James City County, Accomack, Gloucester, Isle of Wight, Northampton, County of York, the towns of Smithfield, and Windsor. This addition would add Surrey, and it's presented by the sheriff, by the police chief and I, with a recommendation of approval.
Okay. Is there a motion?
Now, Mr. Mayor, I move adoption of a resolution authorizing the execution of an updated multi-jurisdictional law enforcement mutual aid agreement.
Second.
Second. You just have to say it slow. But yes, okay, so we have a motion made and seconded that we approve this resolution. Any questions or comments? I don't think there would be. And Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you. And the next item under new business is a resolution authorizing the execution of a contract with Shore Communications for fiber optic cabling.
Yeah, questions, Teresa. Teresa understands this much better than I do. She is, to the extent that we have an on-staff IT person, our finance director, slash budget director, such lead accountant, is that person working with schools.
What we've done is when the administration building, the Public Works Administration building, there was a fire, obviously. Mm-hmm. When they built the new building, they built an IT room in order to cable that actual building and put a server in that building. With money left over, we wanted to connect the municipal building into the Public Works building. The municipal building, where the servers and stuff are in there, are not as secure as they would be in the new building. It also allows for backups of each of their systems. In the meantime, the police department hadn't had a backup in their system. So this also allows to connect the police department to the Public Works Administration building. So all three of them will have backups off-site. They'll all be connected. There'll be one internet connection between all three buildings. Saves a little money and also allows the IT folks in the school division to have one place and for them to be more efficient in doing the IT, not only for us, but for the school division.
Okay, and this is to be done with funding from?
Funding from the police department, the fire department, technology, and the remaining funds from the Public Works building.
So all transfers from inside the existing budget and some leftover money from the building?
Correct. Okay. Correct.
Just want to make sure that was clear. Any questions?
Well, just out of curiosity, I see it referenced a couple of places that it's a contract with Newport News Schools. How did we get tied into that? That seems a little...
Newport News Schools bid it out, and since they bid it out and had competitive bidding, we can buy off of theirs just like a state contract.
So we can buy into that
right.
Particular...
We're leveraging off their bid process.
I was just curious also on, it talks about the price, we're talking about optic fiber, and then it talks about the price of copper. Does the fiber have a copper shield around it, around the outside?
Okay.
I don't know.
I can
went
tell
over
you.
My head.
Okay, and the other thing was we're going to pay them 18% if we don't pay them on time?
We'll pay them on time.
Well, I know, but to agree for 18%, that just sounded very high to me.
You can ask for that to change.
The different copper is the hard line.
Or no.
And it's not a copper shield on fiber. It's the hard line of the like the power supply and any data that's hardwired. And then the fiber optic is the network and the transmission of the signals across the network. So,
yeah. So it's a combination fiber, copper cable.
That's correct. No, no. The fiber is fiber optic cable.
Right.
And the copper is hard line. Which you, okay. Which you
but it runs down the same.
Yes. Conduit.
Wire, basically. Okay.
Runs in the same conduit.
Yeah.
Not the same wire.
Not the same wire. Not in the same feet.
It is not a shielding around the fiber. Okay. Any questions or comments on copper and fiber? If not, can I get a motion that we move forward?
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract with Shore Communications Incorporated for fiber optic cable.
Second.
A motion made and seconded that we approve the resolution. And as a resolution, correct? Yes. Okay. Any other comments? Judy, please.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, and finally, under new business is a resolution.
Oh, wait, got to have an ordinance.
I'm sorry, I didn't see the ordinance on the agenda.
Okay. Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt an ordinance making additional appropriations and transfers for fiscal year 2012 and 13.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded that we approve the ordinance on the fiber optic cabling as well.
Just a comment, Mr. Mayor.
Mm-hmm.
I see that they offer a 1% discount if we pay it within 10 days, and I'm big on taking these discounts since we already have the money. I know it goes through Newport News, but could we? I assume it's we're going to pay through Newport News. Is that right, Teresa?
No.
We'll pay
them directly.
Well,
we have a separate contract.
Okay.
Contract with us,
good.
So just allow the buy-off.
I would like to encourage us to pay it within 10 days and save $300.
We can do that.
Okay. Is that part of your motion, or is that just
no?
That's just a wish.
Just a suggestion.
You desire to do that.
If something might come along, we can't do it.
Gotcha. Agreed. All right. That we have a motion made and seconded. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, and now a resolution making appointments to various boards and commissioners. Someone prepared with a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution to make an appointment to various boards and commissions with the names inserted. And for the Library Advisory Board, I suggest that we leave the Western Precinct open since we do not have any applications from the Western Precinct. In the Eastern Precinct, we insert the name Barbara Whitlow. Her term will expire January 31st, 2016. For the York Pocosin Social Services Board, Judy Wiggins, whose term will expire January 31st, 2017. And for the Architectural Review Board, for the architect Donald F. Booth, Jr., whose term will expire January 31st, 2016.
Second.
Okay, a multitude of seconds. With that said, Judy, please.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay, thank you. And comments of the city manager?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have only two things. First, I just want to say thank you publicly to our public works staff who was ready for the weather that hit us on Friday, and our public safety staff who did everything from assisting people in the ditch to clearing the Hampton Bridge. I just appreciate everything that they did. A night where everyone would have rather been inside, they were outside trying to make it a little bit better for our citizens, and I just want to say thank you to them for that. Also, council members, Late last week, you got an email from us concerning House Bill 2190, which is a bill before the General Assembly that would affect the what types of stormwater BMPs could be used to address impacts of residential and other development. Essentially, what this would do is strip much of our discretion to apply our experience and knowledge of what actually will work in Pocosin based on our experience, topography, elevation, et cetera, and substitute that for that a general statewide series of standards and requirements. As the mayor said 15 minutes ago, we are a unique place, and as such, some of the things that work really well in lots of other places don't work here. And I think we have an advantage to having our engineering staff look at that and determine that almost on a case-by-case basis here, because we're the ones that are going to get the complaints, our citizens are the ones that are going to be impacted, and we're the ones who are going to be asked to help. And I think it would be only appropriate that we also have a voice in what's approved. This would take that away. The bill has been amended somewhat, and you've got the amended bill here, but the basic underlying premise remains. And so what I would ask, if you're comfortable, is to allow me to write on behalf of the city to our delegate in the morning and simply express our concern about this bill and ask him to vote against it.
Council?
Absolutely.
Agree.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely. I hear a consensus.
Thank you. So
that's all I have, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right. Comments to the council, Bud? We'll start down there with you.
Yes. First, I'd like to thank the city staff for the excellent preparation for tonight's meeting and the work session before the meeting. And a comment in that often headlines and news are made because something bad happens. And too often good things happen, and for some reason no one picks up on it, and it doesn't make news. Good things just don't seem to make good news in headlines. Well, last week something really good happened. It was a result of much work and hard effort, and one of our young citizens, a Mr. John Carteret, earned the rank of Eagle Scout. My congratulations to John. It's a very significant accomplishment. John's the son of Libby and Mike Carteret, and I am certain they are very proud of him. They have good reason to be.
Thank you, Bud, and thank you for picking up on that.
Gary? Compliment the city staff as well. I drove from Settlers Landing Road home to Pocosin Friday night. Didn't hit a plowed road until I got to what we call a new bridge on With Creek. So we do better than our neighbors in a lot of cases. And that was all. I agree with what everybody else said.
All right, thank you, Gary. Ray?
Randy referenced earlier this evening the article in today's paper about the so-called Affordable Care Act, which I think is the biggest oxymoron since giant shrimp. whoever it's affordable for, but there was dollar amounts indicated, or at least estimates for most of our neighboring localities, and I wonder if we could get some idea of what that impact will be to us.
We're working on that. Honestly, we don't know yet. We've been working on it for a few weeks.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
But we'll have it, and we'll put it in that budget question and answer sheet that Teresa's keeping
for
you.
That's all.
Okay. Buddy?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to give a big thanks to everybody that was involved in the food drive. Given the weather we had for that whole week, we collected about 2,200 pounds of food. And I don't want to leave anybody out, but specifically Chief Bowen, Sergeant Devers, and Bob Speechley for driving that behemoth of a deuce and a half. And I think we finally figured out why it's so hard to steer, because the left front tire just about fell off on the last day when the chief took it back to the barn. But the city staff, Vicki and Evie and Judy, and the school staff, all the schools donated lots of food, even with the bad weather. The volunteers from Sprint, Thomas Nelson, for the final day, that was a big help. And everyone who donated food, I tell you, it was they came out in droves that last day and donated over 760 pounds of food right there at Farm Fresh. Just a big thank you to everybody. And then the food bank last Tuesday, Thanks to the Pocosin Yacht Club for their help in doing that, and of course, always Vicki and Evie for getting the notices out. And a thanks to the food bank. For the first time, they brought us three meats, which was, everybody was just ecstatic. We had ham, chicken, and strips of catfish, and everybody that picked it up, everybody we delivered it to, just was ecstatic about it. So, thanks to everybody.
Okay, thank you. Henry?
But is that thing every month, that food drive?
Every fourth Tuesday.
Every fourth Tuesday, just so everybody knows, that's every fourth Tuesday. Great event. And again, I echo what everyone else said so here tonight. And I want to thank Mr. Williams and Mr. Furman for coming out and being voices for the citizens. I appreciate that. The more people we can get here, the better off we all are as a city.
Okay. With that said, council had there's a couple things I wanted to make sure y'all are aware of. First, I got a letter from York County, the auditors of the York County Circuit Court Clerk's Office, and a very positive financial audit of that office. I know that we're members of the York Pocosin Court, and that we hear about our internal audits all the time, but we did get a positive report on that as well. So congratulations to the clerk's office for coming through that audit in very high style. Buddy, you leave yourself out on all of those thank yous. Thank you for participating in the in restocking our local parish and our food bank. It was very important. We had gone empty, as you know. And thanks to all the citizens that participated and the local businesses that helped, and as well as the schools for allowing us to bring that deuce and a half with its falling off tire to their location. But it's all about what we do outside of our normal jobs that makes the difference, and that's one of those things. And Buddy, we continue to thank you for your leadership on that. And I think that's all I have this evening. So I know that we have a closed session, and that is pursuant to, let's see if I can find it, section 2.23711A3 and A7, to discuss disposition of publicly held real property and actual litigation, and that is the Big Woods and retail business.
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
Second.
Okay. Motion made and seconded. Judy, please.
Councilman Ayer.
Aye.
Councilman Green.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Freeman.
Aye.
Councilman Southall.
Aye.
Councilman Bernal.
Aye.
And Mayor Hunt.
Aye.
Mr. Mayor, the motion carried by a vote of 6-0.
Okay. We'll go to closed session.